Hey, Lars here from Piano Fantasy. Today we're going to discuss different ways of working the finger exercises of Hanon. As you can see, I have here a whole bunch of books. See? These are all finger exercises. I did these, and you know, it's Philippe, this Plady, this Lily Philippe. And we have, these are not finger exercises, but a school of for pedal. They are, I would call them exercises for learning better pedal. Then we have here the first two books of a whole series from Alberto Jonas. And it's in collaboration with many of the great pianists. See, these are all the collaborators here in the book. And they are only available from Dover edition, the first two volumes. Luckily, I got my hands on a download, PDF download, from the other eight books. Very great exercises. Behrens, exercises for the left hand. Gibi Cáceres. She is the wife, she was the wife of Robert Cáceres, the great French pianist. Excellent exercises, particularly for stretching. Alfred Courtauld, who doesn't know him? The rational principles of pianoforte technique. Then we have Pichna. They are not easy, with a lot of sustained notes, quite difficult. Then we have the Brahms exercises. As you can see on this book, I play these a lot. And then we have the three volumes of Liszt exercises. They're good, but we didn't need Liszt for it, because he makes a very much quite boring exercises, with a few exception exercises, but in general they are quite boring and long and written out in all the tonalities and so on and so on. But they are really inferior when it comes to Brahms. Yes, let's go to the Hanon exercises. We all know this first one, of course. There are teachers who dismiss them nowadays, and I think it's a little bit stupid to dismiss these exercises. They are very good and really good for finger dexterity, and depending on the way you walk at them, they can be even quite effective. Rachmaninoff, he told about the system in Russia in the time that he was a student, and he told that in the first 2 years of his study, all the students in the first 2 years, all the kids, they were still young, very young students in the conservatory, had to learn all the Hanon exercises in all the scales. So the first way is just the way that is written. And then you do them first slowly with raised fingers. Both hands, etc. This is how all the students should learn first these Hanon exercises, all of them. And now with hands together, and you add a little arm movement. So. Like a waves. Let the arm help the fingers. Yeah? So this on the white keys is actually not so difficult, but still effective. Then the second way is to add some different tonalities. This is for some students quite a challenge because many students don't know the scales, they don't know how many sharps and flats every tonality has. So you should first learn the scales and to know what is a G major scale, what is a flat, and so on. And when integrating also some exercises and to transpose them, you have to do to sing in the beginning. When you play it a few times, it starts to get into your system. And the more experience you have, the faster that process will go. It helps you to automate the tonalities. Take, for example, number 4, let's say in D flat. Etc. Then it goes back. The third way is to practice with sustained notes. You can do this in C major, and you can do this in any other scale. Let's take, for example, this. So what I do is first to let the fifth finger sustained. So I will not leave it until it has to play again. You can a little bit play with these. Okay, this finger needs a little bit more, and then you stay a little bit of an okay, and you feel here, always feel, because that is what I told you. It what is most important is how you do the exercise. Important is always have free wrists, and you feel in your lower arm where the muscles of the fingers are, that you activate them. And you start feeling a little bit warm in your muscles. See, and with back, you can do it with a thumb, see? What you do actually is to sustain, to make more independence in the fingers. But in the same time, you use one finger as an anchor point. So, because you can play all the 5 notes as one form, one shape of the hand. And we have to learn to think in positions. Now your anchor, the hand in this position. The same with the right hand. And you will notice that some fingers will be more difficult to keep than others. The thumb is maybe the easiest and the fifth finger, but it gets more difficult when you start to play around with other fingers. Let's say with the third finger, or the second, or the fourth. So I do this now. I have to be more careful. It's with the second finger. And with the third finger, you can do it, and with the fourth finger. This enhances more finger independence. Remember, always keep supple in the wrist. Concentrated fingers, supple wrist, and feel your muscles in your lower arm. And often students forget that, and then they will all relax their arm and get spaghetti fingers at the same time, or they concentrate the fingers and stiffen up in the wrists, and then you getting tired of almost doing nothing. And when you play with spaghetti fingers, it doesn't make any effect. You have no articulation and you have no control on sound quality whatsoever. The fourth way to do to work on the Hanon exercises is to use chords as a grid. So now we use actually the scale as a grid. So take the easiest one, the first, is this one. So the grid is the scale of C major now. But it can also change the grid into seventh chords. For example, this. So let's say I want to stay in C major, so I use this grid. One higher is this grid, see? And another higher is this grid. So how we play this exercise then on it? Very simple. The first note of the you skip, because you also skip in the original exercise the first or the second note, I have to say, second note. So this second note of the grid you skip. So you play 1-1 and then you finish. That's the right grid. Careful, you will more likely to strike wrong notes because of the stretchings. And what can help is with sustained thump, to work more often with that, to really anchor your hand like this and to get this stretch, see? You can do this in different tonalities. It's a little bit more difficult, but it feels nice if you're pleasant here and you feel a little stretch here. It's very good for getting more stretch in your hand. You do this first with the hands separate. Sometimes that's even enough just to do this and mold your hand. Let's take another one that is the diminished chord. So it's this grid. If we take that grid, and let's say we use, when we shift to the next one, we use the white keys. You can also use different scales, or you can go chromatically. And then you, let's say, take this for example. How we do that in this case? See, and I use sometimes now the second, sometimes the thumb, as an anchor point, so that I will not lose my way on the keyboard, so that I lock actually in this chord. All these ways, also you need to think a little bit more because everything is not programmed anymore. You can memorize this and all exercises, but you start to do it in different ways, you suddenly have to think again. It's also good for your brain. The fifth way to work on the Hanon exercises is in octaves, like this. Etc. It's not so difficult on the white keys, but let's take it on the black keys. Take it in B major. with five sharps. So you have to think a little bit. It's fun when you're using other ones, for example this one. I sometimes just pick a few and I do that just because I want to practice my octaves, or I want to do a few double notes because double notes are very effective to make your fingers loose. And we get now to that, we get to point to the sixth way, and that is in thirds. You can use different kind of fingerings in each exercise. You have to try to find what works, what doesn't work. Even when it doesn't work really, but it's possible, it also can be good. Because in the real music, not every situation is easy. We have awkward and difficult situations, and by being able to just, with the same fingering, going over different tonalities without changing the fingering, will make you more experienced with dealing with difficult situations, also in music. So let's take this for example. Like that. And another way, and that's the seventh way is to use the interval of the sixth. You can use different fingerings. Sometimes you want to have more stretch, sometimes you want to focus on the legato in the upper voice, like here. These are a little bit challenging and difficult ways, but that's the whole idea, because they also have a great effect on the fingers and they keep your exercises less boring. Then I want to go to the last two ways to work, and that is using different rhythms, but the rhythms have to be designed in a way that you activate your fingers more than usual. For example, like this. Like that. Is this one. This kind of rhythms that will invite your fingers to be more active, and you will have to use your arm in an efficient way to do that. The last way is to use different articulations. You can play legato, that should be the standard to play notes connected. But you can also play staccato, you can play portato. So from the arm, from the fingers, so non-legato from the arm, take this one. You shake them from your arm. The another way is to play finger staccato. You achieve that actually by to exaggerate your articulation in the fingers. Or you can use accents. Or you combine, you sustain the first one and then you play the other notes pizzicato. So like this. This works best when you sustain the first note in the thumb and then the fifth finger left, and the other way around when you go back. So these are different ways, there are more ways. And then I think that Hanon exercises can be quite effective and certainly not boring. And I was reading an article, some people were claiming that Hanon would even damage your hands. It's just biggest nonsense in the world. I don't think finger exercises will damage your hands. Finger exercises are excellent. What damages your hands is to play the piano in the wrong way. For example, some of those piano gurus who tell you that you should not lift your fingers and get stuck to the stuck to the keys, glued to the keys all the time, and preferably not move too much with your arm. What you do actually is lock your system, lock your physique, your muscles, with the result that you get stiff, you get unnatural way of playing, and eventually you get injuries. I played a lot. I used to practice 6 hours was my minimum. I practiced every day. And there were days that I even practiced 12 hours with a stopwatch. But mostly around 6-7 hours I practiced per day when I was in the conservatory. And I never had, until today, injuries from playing the piano at my hands. And I lift my fingers, I play loud, and I play strong. Strong fingers help you eventually to get a beautiful control on the pianissimos and so on, because strong fingers give more control on the keys. So I'm always an advocate of working with strong hands. Anyway, I hope that you learned something from this video. So don't hesitate to take Hanon and start working on it. They're excellent to work at. So you can make them more interesting using these ways. Although they will not still cover all the techniques. And all these books, which I just showed you, they don't talk about arm movements. Not one of them. Yeah, maybe Jonas talks a little bit about arm, but not in a very systematical way. So better, you can download this book online. You can buy it on my website. The link is in the description. This is all about fingers and arm. And I teach you in a very systematic way how to use your arms and how to use your fingers. There will be also an online course available. Maybe it's already available when you're watching this. And otherwise, check the link, because it will go into launch in the spring. There will be a workshop also to introduce the course, what is covered. Go to there and check it out. Hey, and don't forget to put in the comments some ideas from videos that you would like to see from me. Hit that subscribe button if you didn't do that yet, so that you don't miss out any videos. Hit that like button so that other people know that this is a good video, and it will help my channel so that I can make more videos also in the future. Thank you for watching, and see you the next time.